Episode 229 of CppCast with guest Saar Raz, recorded January 8th, 2020. This episode of CppCast is sponsored by Backtrace, the only cross-platform crash reporting solution that automates the manual effort out of debugging. Get the context you need to resolve crashes in one interface for Linux, Windows, mobile, and gaming platforms. Check out their new Visual Studio extension for C++ and claim your free trial at backtrace.io/CppCast. And by JetBrains, makers of smart IDEs to simplify your challenging tasks and automate the routine ones. Exclusively for CppCast, JetBrains is offering a 25% discount for a yearly individual license, new or update, on the C++ tool of your choice, CLion, ReSharper C++, or AppCode. Use the coupon code JetBrains for CppCast during checkout at www.jetbrains.com. In this episode, we talk about a new project management tool. Then we talk to Saar Raz. Saar talks to us about hacking on the Clang compiler and his work to add concept support. Welcome to episode 229 of CppCast, the first podcast for C++ developers by C++ developers. I'm your host, Rob Irving, joined by my co-host, Jason Turner. Jason, how are you doing today?
I'm all right. Rob, how are you doing?
I'm doing fine. Don't really have too much news to share on my end. You?
No, not really. No okay. Conferences coming up or anything for me to talk about? I mean, that I'm doing, anyhow.
No, it's still early in the year, but I'm sure we'll have lots planned soon enough.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay, well, in that case, I'll get right to some feedback. This week, we got a tweet from Robert McGibbons saying, "I love the show, and my ears perked up when heard you mention Sean Bax's Circle in the context of the Stood in Bed saga. Should have him on for a full episode about Circle." And yeah, I mean, that's definitely something to consider. We have done a couple episodes on other programming languages like Java, .NET, Rust, D. So it's been a while since we did one of those. And I believe Circle is a pretty new language. Like that time we mentioned it when talking about Stood in Bed was the first time I ever heard of it.
Yeah, I think so too. Or, well, who knows how new it is, but it's maybe not got a lot of public consciousness going.
We'd love to hear your thoughts about the show. You can always reach out to us on Facebook, Twitter, or email us at feedback@cpcast.com. And don't forget to leave a review on iTunes or subscribe. On YouTube. Joining us today is Saar Raz. Saar is a tech and C++ enthusiast from Israel. Saar programs in C++ mostly in his free time. In late 2017, he volunteered to implement C++ 20 concepts in the Clang compiler and has been working on that since, now in the process of merging the work into mainline Clang. Other than C++ and tech, Saar also likes graphic design and playing video games. Saar, welcome to the show.
Thank you for having me. Good to be here.
So, are you playing any interesting games right now?
I'm playing Death Stranding. You heard of it?
I don't think so.
I have. It seems like a very interesting game. I have no idea what it's about.
It's like before it came out, like the more trailers I saw of it, the less I knew about the game, so I really like that part. Yeah. Very bizarre kind of game, but
isn't there a baby in a backpack?
There is. Yeah. It involves some babies and some carrying stuff around
in backpacks.
I thought it all makes sense once I started playing it, but it still doesn't. Maybe it will someday.
Oh, what kind of game is it? What's the gameplay like?
Best way to describe it is, do you know that the thing when you have, I know, a bunch of stuff in your car and you have to move it to your house? You try to like pile on a bunch of stuff onto yourself so you don't have to do too many round trips back to the car. So that's the game, basically.
It's moving stuff around.
Yeah, but you really don't want to have a lot of round trips because there are like monsters in between that if you touch them, then there's like an explosion, an atomic explosion.
It sounds like that that old brain tweezer that's like, you have a wolf, a lamb, and a, I don't know, whatever, on one side of the river. You need to transport them, but none of the two can ever be left alone together across the river, and you can only carry two with you at the time. That's what it sounds like.
Yeah, but if they are on the same boat, then there's a huge explosion.
Okay. What's the name of the game again?
Death Stranding.
Death Stranding. All right, I'm just going to look that up, because what the heck. All right. Make a note for later.
Yeah. Well, in the meantime, we have a couple news articles to discuss. Feel free to comment on any of these, Saar, and then we'll start talking more about the work you've been doing on the Clang compiler, okay?
Cool.
Okay, so this first one is from Vector of Bull's blog, and it's a new decade, a new tool, and it's a very long post where he is going over this new tool he created, but first going over why he felt this tool was necessary. And it's basically a project manager, not another package manager, not another build tool, but a tool you can use to manage those things. It's called DDS, which is, I think it stood for Drop Dead Simple, right?
Did you, I got read through lost this? In this article. Okay.
Me too, actually.
I can say I have confirmed, in fact, because this is completely off topic, but several months ago I asked Twitter if I should read Harry Potter because I said I knew it would be a huge investment for me because I'm a slow reader. Mm-hmm. And I have confirmed via the Kindle app that I, in fact, read at one half the speed of the average reader. Because it'll be like, you have 90 hours left in the book. The average reader finishes Harry Potter in 50 hours. And I'm like, I am, in fact, a slow reader. But yes, it looks like it's meant to work with other build tools. It's not on its own, right?
Right. And also with other package managers. It looks like he's configured in such a way that it could be the library or package manager itself. But if you are using VC package or Conan, then you could use this with that. And the idea is when you actually, you know, go to build something, it's pretty simple, like, you know, just DDS and the target, like MSVC or Clang or GCC. So it certainly seems like a promising idea. He's definitely saying this is just an alpha right now. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Do you have any thoughts on this one, Saar?
One nice point I picked up from the article is that he was aiming to, like, solve... not sacrifice the small edge cases for the big for the large majority of libraries that don't need them, which is like a good approach, I think. But I haven't played around with it yet. Maybe I will.
I also kind of picked up on this on the aspect that you're saying, Saar. And then there's this one quote, admittedly closer to the beginning, that really caught my eye. He says, if you have qualms with me saying that most projects are not special, it is very likely that your project is not special. And as a trainer, I run into this all the time and talking to people in the C++ community that, like, everyone feels like, oh, we're doing something special, so we have to do X and Y. We're allowed to invoke undefined behavior because we're doing something special. No. Like, no one is actually doing anything that different than anyone else. Well, very few people are.
Yeah. Okay. This next one we have is a blog post from Corentin Jabot. Hopefully I didn't mispronounce that. We had him on a couple months ago, and he wrote this post, Waiting for Stood in Bed, Very Large Arrays in Clang. And this kind of refers to the ongoing stood in bed discussion. We've mentioned several articles about that recently. But in this post, he specifically talks about one thing that you might do now without stood in bed, which is just including large arrays in your C++ code and why it's so slow. And he decided to take it upon himself to look into a possible change in Clang and went to start implementing it to see if he could speed that up. And he says he, you know, admits he still has a lot more work to do before he could try to maybe get this merged back into Clang. But he did get some gains, I think about like a third the time to compile an example program with a large array of ints.
And specifically, he implemented an AST node that is optimized for large arrays of literals.
Right.
And but
yeah, that was pretty cool.
Yes, I was going to say, of the three of us, I'm pretty sure only one of us here has actually hacked on Clang. So yeah. I'm curious about Saar's opinion.
I actually read through the article and I it brought back memories, I think, of like things I tried to implement. And Corentin, you ran into similar problems, like facing like enormous accident, like you just run into this function which is like super complex, but then you like you just, you know, hack stuff around and make it work for this simple case, and then you iteratively make it better. I was actually very happy reading that article. It was like very encouraging that he didn't like quit at any point and just like stuck through. So props to him for that. And it's like a very good approach.
And it sounded like, if I read the article correctly, that the way array literals, or where the way initializer lists are parsed, that is, he has like 100 places ultimately to change in the code, something like that, and hasn't quite done all of them yet. I think that's what I read. Do you have similar experience? Like, trying to find all of the places that you needed to... Well, we can talk more about your work in a moment, too. But
yeah, there's a lot of overlap. but yeah, a thing he said there is that finding where to put the code is like... most of the work is that, just like reading through the code and finding the place to change.
Right.
And you often like put it in the wrong place, then you realize it later and fix that. After the fact, after like a night of debugging, then, but yeah, we'll talk about more about that later.
I do think, though, he does ultimately a good job of highlighting, in my opinion, the conclusion isn't we need to hyper-optimize arrays of literals. It was, let's just go ahead and come up with an embed solution. Because there's so many use cases for it. Use cases that even, I've been a huge fan of embed since the beginning, and things that I hadn't thought of that he outlines at the top of the article.
Yeah, definitely. Okay, this next thing we have is an announcement that Nicolas Jussoudis has written another book, and this is C++ Move Semantics. You can check out the details at cppmove.com. And this is an ebook, so I think you can like get it now on LeanPub, and it's going to be updated iteratively, but you can go and get it now, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Who says buy early, save money?
And we've never had Nikolai on before, have we?
We have not.
We should consider having him on, because he's written several books and given lots of talk on C++. We should try him on.
I have something of a morbid curiosity as to how long this book is going to be. Like, I want to know what the current page count is.
Yeah, that's a good question. Yeah. Is there really a full book's worth on move semantics? Yeah.
I feel like I want to hope that there isn't. And I teach move semantics, right? So
yeah, but like the description of the book is like I'm gonna explain the like reasoning behind move semantics, why they're like useful and stuff, and then all the pitfalls and all the things you need to know. So that part is probably like pretty bulky.
That's the bulk of it. Yeah.
I
see now it does say 25,000 words and it is 75% complete.
Oh, okay.
Now, considering that I had just been looking at my own personal reading speed, I know that all of Harry Potter is a little over 1 million words, so I don't really know how to scale that to 25,000 words, though.
Yeah.
Well, that means it should take you less than 90 hours, though, so that's
good. I would imagine that's true. I think 25,000 actually puts it in the relatively short side.
Yeah. Okay. And then the last thing we have is, you know, last week it was just Jason and I, and we spent some time talking about all the different conferences coming up this year. And one that we, I think we may have mentioned, but we didn't have a formal announcement for yet, was Core C++. And they did make the formal announcement right after we got that episode out.
Like 12 hours later, basically. Yeah.
So it's going to be May 25th to 27th, and you can submit your talk right now. And the deadline for submissions is going to be February 15th for Core C++. And it's in Israel again, right? Is it the same place?
It's not the same place. But Sarg, I think, could talk more about it, yeah.
A different place, not that very far, not that much far away, but so like in Tel Aviv area.
It's farther from the beach, though, I might say.
Yeah, it is. It is. yeah, but you should definitely come. It was a very, I enjoyed it very much last year. That was actually my first conference. My first C++ conference ever, but it was like it was pretty high quality, and the talks were good, and the people were good.
So after that, you did Core C++, and I know you went to CppCon. Did you do any other conferences last year?
No, not yet. Not yet.
Okay. So you are planning to submit to Core C++ again, I assume?
I want to. I don't have any ideas yet.
Okay.
Well, you got a month, 5 weeks.
Yeah, but I'm have a lot of work this time.
So one thing you did not mention in your bio, and I think it's a good opportunity at the moment, is what do you do? Do you use C++ professionally?
No, actually not right now. I did for a short time during my military service. Which is like where I picked up on it again after like I relearned it and got the pretty much dumb language. But like since then, I've only been doing side projects with C++.
Okay.
Unfortunately.
Okay. It's, you know, most people don't think I programmed in C++ during my military service, but that's not that unusual in Israel, correct? Yeah. Okay.
Okay. So do you want to start off by telling us how you got interested in working on the Clang compiler?
Yeah, it was like, it was never, I never like sat at home and thinking which side project I should do now. And hacking on Clang just came up. It was more of a gradual slippery slope thing. Started out, with me working on another C++ side project, was sort of like a game engine of sorts. It's pretty early stages of it. And the first thing the main thing that got me interested in that direction is when I got into a situation where the compiler I'm using and the tool chains available to me were not enough to solve the problem that I was facing. For example, in that specific case, I was using GCC with the concepts implementation that was available back then. So I was like I was stoked that it was very cool that GCC did have an implementation way back then, and I wanted to use concepts because they were cool. But I then ran into like limitations that GCC had. And the language as a whole, for example, I was having a hard time debugging like heavily templated code, which is like I think a problem many people are facing.
Right.
Like the tool chain that I had, GCC, didn't really allow me to work on this. I was feeling that I was like hitting the limits of what GCC could provide in terms of like debugging, and I was getting like absurdly large error messages and compile times, and the compiler wasn't was at its limit, which is the point where I said I have that the only way forward in this project is to do something about it, or you know, drop the project or do something like less like move to a lower standard version and switch compilers or something. But like the only way to really go forward this project was to do something about this hitting this limit on the tool chain. The first thing I did was static print, which Jason featured on his C++ Weekly.
I did. That was a long time ago.
Yeah, it was a long time ago. That was like my first attempt at making things better for myself with GCC. It was like this very simple idea. I'd have just this statement that we put somewhere in your source and give it some compile time thing, and it would just print the compile time thing during compilation.
So really handy idea.
Yeah, it was very simple. It was very understandable and very useful, and like a simple tool that could be useful for a lot of things. For example, I wanted to use it to do like poor man's profiling of my compile times. It's like, you know, put a static print before and after some things and see how long they take to compile and see the bottlenecks of it. That's what was the original premise. So I said, like, how hard could it be to actually add this right now? I knew that there was some like papers in circulation that were gonna add something like this, constexpert trace, I think it was called,
right?
But it wasn't available to me at that point, and it probably wouldn't be for another couple of years. But the cool thing about hacking on compilers is that you get to use the features right away. You don't have to wait for anything. You may have to wait for them to use it, for example, at work or something, but this was like very much a, you know, a debugging thing that I had to use to write the code. So I just went for it, and I guess this was what got me hooked. And after I did that, I ran into the problem that I needed a faster compiler with concept. And it seemed that no work was being done at the moment to actually get this. Like, it wasn't coming anytime soon. And then I also said, like, how hard could it be? I guess the basic thing is having something that you this problem that you ran into and you want to solve and you're passionate about it, and it seems like easy enough, and that was the thing for me that got me interested, I guess.
So did you start by trying to improve GCC's constexpert support and compile times? Concept support, excuse me.
No, I didn't. Mostly because of my experience hacking on GCC and the static print project. GCC's code is pretty tough. A friend told me that Clang's code is simpler and more well-written. So I thought, implementing it in Clang might be more, might be easier than actually trying to optimize GCC, which is like this very complex thing. And I'd had to like understand the implementation as it is right now, and understand a lot of things about the compiler. It seems like a higher barrier of entry for me.
Right.
And then just start, you know, trying to hack this thing together, small steps.
I'm sorry, go ahead.
I know. I'm...
Okay, before I forget, I'm also curious, what is the current status of your static print patch? Is that still just living on? Like, are you still maintaining it? Is it been merged?
No,
No,
I'm not. Using my current knowledge in Clang, it could maybe add it in a day or something. But
in Clang, okay.
Yeah. And I have this in GCC. I could probably try to hack this together, but I'm more focused on concepts right now.
Right.
So maybe I'll go back to that someday.
Just curious.
So what was the learning curve like to really get going in Clang? I mean, I know you said you didn't do much in GCC, but do you feel like you got productive fairly quickly? What was it like?
So in GCC, doing static print, I actually got productive surprisingly quickly. I managed to get the thing working in like a couple of days, maybe like 3 days, getting like an initial version working, which was like a very important, like positive feedback that I needed right. to prove to myself that this is even like a logical thing to try to do. Because like it doesn't seem that way. It doesn't seem that you can just walk into a compiler and manage to do anything. Because they're like advertised as these like things you have to like do. You have to do compilers your whole life to like understand anything about them. But,
right.
So it was very surprising and suspicious that I could get this working so fast. The work I did on GCC was just like the work I did in Clang initially was not very, correct or it wouldn't get like merged into GCC just like that. The fact that it's like working right now it doesn't mean it's like trunk ready quality code. But it's not expected to be, I think. The thing I did with concepts was trying to break down concepts. I just went through the paper, the concepts paper, and broke it down into these steps that each of them was like, describe it in my head, like the things that we need to do, like conceptually need to do. And there were like, I don't know, one or like a few, like two, three things that I needed to do to get that part through. For example, first thing I did was I'm going to add the concept declaration, which is just like a very simple thing. It's just like, you know, a template with the concept keyword, a name, and then an expression. This is a very simple thing. And once you look at this like small little problem, you can you suddenly it's suddenly not this like huge one of the biggest features in C++ to date. It's this like small thing that you need to add. And once you have that, it's like it was very similar to static print for me. Which, by the way, the thing I did with static print and most of concepts was just like, you know, I have this thing that I want to add, and the compiler already has a lot of things from C++ implemented.
Mm-hmm.
And the thing I mostly did was just, you know, copy paste things around, just like find the closest thing to a concept that I could in the language. Let's, you know, do a file search for every occurrence of that name and copy it, and change name concept. It was like this, mechanical process, and it worked pretty quickly. Compilers are even built in a way that, like, for example, if you add a new declaration, a new, like, a concept declaration, if you add it to the somewhere in the compiler, and you try to compile it, it will tell you like the places where you need to put it will pop up pretty quickly. For example, you have a switch case that handles everything, and it will tell you to add this case in this switch over here to handle concepts. And then if you look at this, like the very small things, it breaks it down into these like small problems that become like manageable. You don't really know what you're doing at first. You're just copying and pasting things around, but I was able to get like most of the feature implemented just by doing like copy pasting and really not understanding anything too deeply. But So this got me to like a state where I could write a simple program with concepts and it would compile.
That sounds like an important moment to take for a second here and say, and this is why you don't want defaults in your switch statements. Otherwise, you would not have been able to easily find all of those places.
Yeah, yeah.
It would take much longer.
Yeah, yeah. It's a good listen. No, but like, it is true that the Clang, for example, is very, it's like a very impressive piece of engineering, of software engineering. Code is built like very, very well, and like built, and every line of it is very well thought out and written to prevent future problems and make it relatively easy to come in and make changes without too much hassle.
That's cool.
Yeah, so I was very like positively impressed with the code. And it's like C++11 using like relatively modern features and has a lot of, you know, RAI and like templates when needed, and it's very it's a good piece of code.
Did you have any advice or resources when you were going through this process that were helpful to kind of get working in Clang, or do you have any advice you can give to someone who wants to get started in Clang themselves?
Yeah, the first thing is finding something that you want to solve, you know, like the std embed thing. It's like this very it's probably a problem that the tool chains have right now. And once you find that thing that that you wish your compiler or language could do, but can't right now, and you know it seems simple enough, even like simple enough could mean that there is something like very similar in the language already. That does something very similar. If I just like copy and paste this thing and just change it a little bit, even if you don't know how to do this yet, but you have this thing that is not like radically different, then, or even like this big thing that you can break down into these steps, just so that's the first step. Just finding this problem that will and it'll get you started. Mm-hmm. After that, you would probably do well to read a little bit of manuals. Like Clang comes with a bunch of like developer manuals, which can be like a little scary at first. But the things you don't read in the manual, you would discover later after like a nighttime session of debugging. When you do something that's you thought was okay, but was actually very wrong, and you found out the wrong way. The code is good, but it doesn't always protect you from making big mistakes. But you shouldn't be afraid of making those mistakes. In the blog post of Corentin's, he mentioned that he ran into the function that handles initialization, or the file that handles initialization in Clang, mm-hmm. which is like this huge file with like millions of edge cases, not literally millions, but it was like a huge file that handles like what happens when you take this array of structs and initialize it with inline initializer lists, and you can do like all sorts of crazy things with this, and the compiler has to handle all of them.
Right.
And it's often the case that when you read the code of a C++ compiler, you find it hard to believe that someone could write this code that handles this much edge cases. But that shouldn't be that shouldn't keep you from trying to hack on it anyway. The code was built like iteratively, adding stuff over time, so you don't have to like at the first try write code that handles all the edge cases. Mm-hmm. But you need to do the simplest thing you can. Just try the simplest solution you can think of. Copying something that seems like similar enough, and do just the simplest solution without thinking about all the edge cases. And improve the code via iterations, just like every piece of code. You write some tests, you find out something doesn't work, you debug it, you find out what was wrong, and then think of the simplest solution that would incorporate the new information. But the thing, the best tip I can give is just don't be afraid to get things wrong. Just copy paste things around, you don't need to handle all the complexity at first. You just need to try the simple things, and by trying the simple things first, you get enough track record with debugging and understanding the code that the more complex things you'd have to do later would become simpler as you progress, because debugging a code base is like the best way to actually get to know the code base.
Right.
So clone the sources, get them, compile them in debug mode, and start and do the simple thing, the simplest thing you can think of first. And it probably will be simple to do the simple thing, surprisingly simple.
Discuss, and then you're hooked.
Final. What?
And then you're hooked.
Yeah. And once you get that positive feedback that you can do something, if you get the simple solution working, you probably can get the eventual thing working as well through iterations. You just need to like break it down into simple steps and start working. Oh, and a very important tip is to use a strong machine to compile the thing. Otherwise, you would if you don't have to like buy a very strong machine first. But if you get into it like seriously, then consider buying a cloud machine to do your compilation on, because compile times of like LVM can be tough, right, especially in debug mode. I use a strong cloud machine to do all my compiling and
So have you continued then to work on these patches since you first presented on it at Core C++?
Yeah, I'm still doing this in this free time, in any free time I'm getting. Not getting a lot of it, but yeah, it's like an hour every morning, after work, before work.
An hour every morning, I would say, is a decent commitment for a side project.
Personally. Yeah, I've been working on it for a while, but it's also it's at the point where it's not only depending on me right now, because I'm in the process of merging it in, so it also. I'm also like waiting for a code review, which is like so if I had all the time in the world and would only depend on me, probably be done right now. But it's like actually getting it merged is like this slower process, but it's a very good one. The code did improve a lot from that process.
So is what you're trying to merge in feature complete for C++ 20 concepts?
Right now,
as far as you know,
what was the question?
I said, as far as you know, since you were talking about all the edge cases earlier, I was just making a bit of a joke.
As far as I know, what?
That it's feature complete. As far as you know, it's feature complete.
Yeah, it is. It is feature complete. The biggest new feature that was added to concepts was the chir syntax. You can just write a concept name before any auto keyword. That was like the newest thing. And actually my CppCon presentation like gave me the boost I needed to actually get this one implemented. Yeah, right now it's feature complete. It's actually also pretty stable because I had a lot of people in the community just helping me test it, just using it in their projects and reporting bugs. And so I fixed a lot of them, and there's nothing that replaces actual like user feedback for detecting bugs. You can write all the tests that you want, but like people actually using it in real projects was like the best way to detect bugs. So I'm pretty satisfied with how the code turned out in the end. Right now I'm working on actually merging it into Clang. Hopefully I'm going to get it in time for Clang 10.
Okay.
The deadline for that is in 7 days from now.
What in the world are we doing taking your time up right now?
So like everything is implemented, so I'm basically just waiting for CR and fixing CR problems. I have about 5 out of 10 commits, like the thing I mentioned earlier where I broke down the feature into like small steps.
Yes.
So I'm like 5 steps in like the merging process. And most of the other remaining steps have already been through a few like CR iterations.
What does CR stand for?
Code review.
Oh, okay. Just making sure.
Richard Smith is doing my CR. He is the editor of the standard and the also code owner of Clang.
Right.
A very encouraging thing to know is that Richard also started out his like compiler endeavors, but just like, you know, having this problem that he needed to solve in a compiler and cloning the sources and copying and pasting things around. we talked about it back in CppCon, and he said that he also just started by copying and pasting things around, and now he's like implemented most features of C++ 11, 14, and 17.
Wow.
In the Clang compiler. So there is hope. like that's the way actually to start working on stuff like that. And for example, the first feature he implemented was the ranged for loop. So that's like a very encouraging thing about. So he's doing my code review. Like a code review from Richard takes a while to fix, but. It's all very, very helpful, and I'm also learning a lot about the compiler from his code review, which is like very is very much in a like teaching in this like very welcoming and teaching attitude, like explaining why things are the way they are, and just getting this code review is a very helpful thing to actually get to know the compiler better. You don't always you can't learn everything through debugging, so that's like I guess the final step of actually like learning the things, how things work.
Sounds incredibly helpful. Educational.
Yeah, very educational, and he's a very nice guy also.
So we have not yet actually mentioned this, but your fork is currently on Compiler Explorer.
It is, yeah.
So anyone Matt, wants to can go play with it, yeah.
Yeah, Matt was kind enough to put it on pretty early, and I guess that was a very big boost to the stability, because like people were just experiment with it and find bugs. Since then, a lot of more people who were hacking on compilers got their like experimental build up in Compiler Explorer. So there's like a bunch of experimental builds on the site, and like Clang with experimental concepts, with experimental bunch of other implementations of things, which is pretty cool, and it allows people to experiment with the feature early on and to get feedback from people. So you can try it out there, or you can build You can go to concepts.godbolt.org, and it pops up this screen with GCC concepts and Clang concepts set up, so you can try concepts right now, or you can even build the compiler yourself. There's instructions on my GitHub, and it's not very hard. LVM is not very hard to build. It takes a long time, but it's not very difficult.
Right.
There's a tutorial on their site, and it uses CMake, so it's pretty cool. And another very cool integration that I got recently was with JetBrains, which were like, I came up with this idea that the very cool thing to have would be like the most annoying thing working with concepts back then, back in when I was using them for my own project, was that my IDE would not understand like what the heck I was doing.
Right.
Like the entire code was errors, and I was wondering when would the time come when my IDE would understand the code that I'm writing. So I came up to JetBrains, and the good thing about hacking on Clang is that it has built-in IDE integration through ClangD. Mm-hmm. So they basically could use my branch and get like instant IDE support for concepts, which is very cool. It's another incentive to work on Clang, because you can get like IDE support like out of the box from it.
So are you using C Lion then for this hacking?
I am using C Lion, although I'm not using concepts in my LVM implementation. But
couldn't. Well, I mean.
Yeah, like LVM is still C++ 11, you can use C Lion 2019.3, I think that is, mm-hmm. and it has built-in concept support with like auto completion based on concepts, and
nice.
It's very very it's very cool, and I like it a lot. So yeah, that was also a very nice surprise that. That my work, I didn't know that when I started out, but then working on Clang would give me also IDE support. It was very, very cool surprise. And JetBrains were very, were awesome in this process as well.
That's very cool.
Very cool.
Yeah.
I want to say also, just for my own personal experimentation, your patches seem to be, at least at the moment, quite complete and robust. I did a C++ Weekly episode using some of them, but I was doing things like constraining the return type of a auto return type function with the ter syntax. And GCC would allow me to do it, but would ignore the constraint ultimately. It would let me return anything. But your patches would properly fail to compile.
Cool, thanks.
Yeah.
GCC did have... big change merged recently into their concepts implementation, so I'm not sure about the state of it right now, but
yeah, I'm sure it's all like I've refrained from submitting any bug reports on any of these things because I know everyone's actively working on it, so I was just going to wait until everyone said our concepts implementation is stable, and then I'll start comparing them against each other and stuff more.
Yeah.
Okay. Was there anything else you wanted to go over before we let you go, Saar?
Yeah, there's another cool thing that I recently... there's C++20 has the concepts header.
Mm-hmm.
Which gives you like standard concepts you can use for your for your programs, like, I don't know, same as, which is the concept that checks the two types are the same, or callable, or assignable from, or all these like standard concepts. This concept header is not yet available in libc++, But I recently learned that Christopher Di Bella is working on, actually, he has an implementation that's working with my branch, and he is working on merging it into Leap C++. So maybe we'll get that support too sometime. Nice. He said he was inspired by my work to start working on it, so it was pretty cool. Pretty cool side effect. I think that's it.
Sounds like hacking on. Okay, go ahead. Sorry.
Go ahead. No, you can go ahead.
It sounds like hacking on these compilers is a great way to meet people.
Yeah, it is. And it got me to CppCon. So it was the biggest, probably the best thing I could have asked for out of this thing. So
right.
And CppCon does pay the travel expenses, and I probably wouldn't go there if it wasn't for this project. So that was a very nice gift that I didn't even think I would get. But
yeah, I think, and I at this point, I think I've officially reached the point where I'm going to mention this on literally every single episode, Rob. Since there do seem to be some misconceptions that comes up, people misunderstand what the conferences are willing to pay for or not. CppCon absolutely is willing to pay for your travel and hotel and ticket. If you're your airline ticket, your hotel, and your entrance to the conference, if you are a speaker, you have to request the support. They prefer that your company pays for it. But if you're someone like Saar, who doesn't have a company that's able to pay for this or willing to pay for it, then they will pay for it. And you just have to provide your own food, which admittedly can be expensive. But I've also watched some of the students bum food off of people and eat very cheaply. So I know there are options.
Yeah, and conferences are awesome. I'm really hoping to go to more this year. I just need to. I have my motivation to think of another topic.
Yes. Yeah.
The talks are a lot of work, but I think it's worth it in the end. It's a very unique experience.
It is. Yeah.
For me, like meeting Richard Smith was worth the entire thing. yeah.
Okay. Well, it's been great having you on the show today, and great work for everything you've done for Clang, getting concepts added.
Thank you for having me.
Thanks for coming on. Yeah.